Very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the third day of 4th Smart Cities Indian Expo 2018. We now start with our very first session for the day, which is on roads and highways of India. The chairperson for the day is Mr. Sanket Bhondve, IAS. I take immense pleasure on inviting him on stage. He is Deputy Secretary Highways, Project Director, World Bank Technical Assistant, Ministry of Road and Transport Highway, Government of India. So please join us on stage. The rest of the panelists for the day are Mr. Sudhir, Mathur, Senior Scientist, CSIR, Central Road Research India, Mr. Rakesh Kumar Agrawal, Engineer-in-Chief, PWD India, Mr. Rahul Gupta, Executive Director, NHIDCL India. Please join us on stage. Thank you. I now hand over the session to our chairperson for the day. Thank you.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everybody on the dais. Respected sir, ma'am. Today, actually, let me correct myself. Amit Ghosh sir was going to come here and give a presentation on sustainable roads and highways of India. I am Sanket Bhondve. I am an IAS officer of 2007 batch, MP Carder. I have recently joined as Deputy Secretary Highways, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, looking after the Bharatmala, the new ambitious Bharatmala project. And basically my role is from the ministry level, bridging NHAI, NHIDCL to the ministry in the policy making and policy amendments. So we'll just move forward. Actually, the presentation will focus on sustainable roads and highways of India. As you know that this is one of those sectors which have come up very fast and in a very different way. We can see that is the happening one, a sunshine sector. In the presentation, the title is Sustainable Roads and Highways of India, but the first point I will be focusing on the highways, the facts, the overview, and then we'll come into the sustainable part. This is the way we'll be heading. Overview of highways, then obviously Bharatmala project, Pariyojana, many of you must be knowing about this, and there's a lot of information on the net. It is a big word here. Again, slightly, I will tell about the Sagarmala, which is in convergence with Bharatmala. Sustainable roads and highways in two parts. I will be talking on climate resilience of national highways and the carbon footprint. So a more detailed part, I will be speaking on this. And then the solutions or the mitigation measures we will be going and the way forward. Any questions, any queries, you can ask in between. Most welcome. Now, as I told earlier, the overview of highway sector, this is a graph of just and how we have proceeded leaps and bounds. If we compare 2014 to 2017-18, the awards given and the road constructed is tremendous. Once it was just 12 kilometers per day, and today it is more than actual is 27 kilometers per day. And the target is to do the construction rate should be, construction rate is the rate where we build national highways every day per kilometer. It is almost 40 kilometers per day. The target we have kept for next year. As I also belong to the policy making part, lot of things, new changes, intervention, innovations were done in the policy making to make the implementation and execution swift. We have Mr. Rahul here from NHIDCL. When he will speak, he will also say on that. We have NHI as our major premium organization, which is an implementing and execution organization. But see, implementation and execution will go much far ahead and will be smooth if there are policy making changes and there are some intervention which will help them. So as we know that the National Highway Development Program took place some 1 or 2 decades back. We had the Golden Quadrilateral, which was quite successful. We had the North, South, East, West corridors. But along with this success, there came some hiccups. There were some languishing projects, which were due to for many reasons, like land acquisition, for some issues, litigation, etc. So then we came up with one-time fund infusion for them and 100% equity divestment model to revive these languishing projects. Today, there are more than 10,000 kilometers of languishing projects, but we have come up in a helpful way to bring them out. And the new financing models, मुझे लगता है BOT थोड़ा पुराना हो गया है, build, operate, transfer or whatever, build, operate, lease and transfer, bolt, BO, BOT is now not the current buzzword. The current buzzword is TOT, and I will say HAM. Most of you must be knowing it. HAM stands for hybrid annuity model, and the TOT is obviously toll operate transfer. In TOT, let me tell you, because I'm telling about the highway sector, we have come up with almost 9 bundles of project in Gujarat and adjoining state, and more than 7,000 crores have been awarded in TOT. And this is really a good part sign of the highway. You can again see that from 50,000, it has tripled to 1,58,000 crores. Let me tell you, 10 lakh crores. We are building roads and infrastructure. I will come on Bharatmala, I will go into the detail. We are going for a 10 lakh crore. When I'm saying, I mean it. Aisa nahi ki main galti se kuch zyada bol gaya ya kam bol diya. 10 lakh crore of all this empire is being coming up, is in the way. You can see the graph and it's quite self-speaking. Bharatmala. Bharatmala, I will say, is really a mala across the India. Roads, connectivity, connecting corridors, cities. We have divided into 6 components. I will come on that. Golden Quadrilateral had its own pros and cons, but unlike Golden Quadrilateral, it is way ahead in many things. Apart from these 5 bullet points, which you can read there, let me tell you, we are focusing on direct connectivity of greenfield highways. पहले ऐसा होता था कि एक point से दूसरे point पे जाना था, तो बीच में जितने सारे town और गांव आए, उनको जोड़-जोड़ के एक road बनती थी, simple, और जरूरत भी थी. But now, in the OD, we directly have a crow flight because the land is now costly, land acquisition is a issue, distance gets shorter. Let me tell you, the Delhi-Mumbai freight corridor, which is coming up, again, it's very ambitious. We have taken almost a straight alignment wherever we could get it. And again, the best point is it gets the regional development, a balanced regional development. Jo aas-paas ke gaon aur towns hai, tier 1, tier 2, they come up, they get an opportunity for development. It has saved, it is short of 125 kilometers. The Delhi-Mumbai corridor, which is coming up with this alignment, is 125 kilometers shorter than the Agra-Bombay highway, the old Agra-Bombay highway. So that's the one point. Second, redefining road development, multimodal integration, yes. Multimodal logistic hubs. Now this buzzword again, Ministry of Commerce is dealing with this. MMLP we call. We are coming in Varanasi and Nagpur, MMLPs, and there are almost 15 places in India where we will be coming up with MMLPs. Ministry of Road Transport and Highways is looking after the DPR part. We are ready with the DPR in Varanasi and we are coming up in Nagpur. Again, I will say it's a part of Bharatmala because many factors affect. If we talk about the just about the road or the highways, it will not suffice, but we need some logistic hubs and all sort of facilities in that. critical infrastructure gaps. Let me tell you, we have sorted out 190 congestion points, 190 choke points. Now, these choke points are there. Even if you go from Mumbai to Pune expressway, I stay in Pune. I travel to Mumbai. Recently, in the last 3-4 years, I often get stuck up. You know why and where. Those who are often, anybody who often travels Mumbai, Pune, or at least once, kab travel kiya tha aapne? Abhi kiya tha. Kahi beech mein jam bhim laga hoga. So we remember of the old Mumbai Pune highway. Ki subah 7 baje nikle hai, to sham ko 7 baje Bombay pahunchenge. It used to take sometimes 10 to 12 hours to reach, and I have traveled when I was a kid. And when the expressway came up in 1990s decade, the end of the 1990s decade, it was a superb project. But again, with the traffic and all, you can feel. So there are three choke points. With an example of the case study, there are three choke points, and then we are making the bypass and ring road. Many tier 2 and tier 3 towns which are coming up very fast, again there are choke points. So out of 191 congestion choke points, we have already started working on 100 choke points in the first phase. Two choke points have been completed, address, and soon 40 choke points before the March 2019 will be completing. So that was the third point. Road safety, we all are just sitting safely because we came safely on the road. Road safety can't be ignored, and I think this is such an important point to be considered, so we can't neglect it. Road safety itself is a very big component to study and to talk. Integrating national and economic corridors, I will not talk too much because everyone must be knowing ki jab main itni baat kar raha hu MMLPs and why freight corridors, so what does it mean? To be specific, this is on the net also. You can go and go into details. But six components. Now see the last one, expressways. What I was speaking of a crow flight greenfield expressway, it is here. Andhra Pradesh is coming up very fast in expressways. Indore, Bhopal, a greenfield expressway is coming up 147 kilometers south of the present road. Again, there are a lot of proposals from all the states. So all the states are coming. We have a grand challenge mechanism. See, land is very important. When I talk of these roads and all network, you say, yehi toh bolte ja raha hai. He's speaking and aisa bol raha hai, jaise ki jadu ki chhadi aur aise road bana rahe hai. Aisa nahi hai, you know. Land being the most important resource and to build any asset, chahe wo building ho, or roads toh aisa hai ki matlab it connects everything. So I feel that while coming on the roads also, I will talk on the latter part, but coastal hai isme, border hai, national corridors hai, inter corridors hai. When I talk of the border and international connected roads, Mr. Rahul is here, and he will, when he will speak, and you can ask him about the NHIDCL part, the National Highway Infrastructure Development Corporation Limited. See, we have two major arms. One is NHI, as you all know. Second is NHIDCL. Now, NHIDCL looks after this border row, international borders and strategic areas. Now, strategic areas, you must know, one is Zozila Pass, which was recently, the foundation stone was laid by the Honorable PM, just on 19th of May. It has the longest tunnel in Asia with PS the Middle Himalayas. Middle Himalayas ko pehli baar PS karke ja rahe the. Switzerland mein to bahut log kahenge ki are bade bade tunnels hai. But yes, we are the longest tunnel in Asia. And NHIDCL is looking after that. Other, most of the other part are looked after NHAI. Obviously, 80 to 85% of the roads will be made, highways will be made by NHAI, and some part by the state support agency. For example, in MP, MPRDC, we will fund them. For example, in Pune, PMRDA is doing a 128 kilometer ring road part, and it is the agency. It is not MSRDC. The Maharashtra State Road Development Corporation. It is PMRDA. So it depends on the state support agencies. So there are 3 to 4 types of agencies, which is NHI is a major one. Corridors, economic corridors, national corridors, yes. And when we talk of corridors, it's really the today what we are planning is to have at least 70 to 75 meters of width. So we can go for an 8-lane expressway or 8-lane road, because that's the future. Aaj banaoge to 15 saal baad usko badhana hai, fir wo brownfield ban jata hai. today's greenfield becomes tomorrow's brownfield. Again, you have to go for some. Now, that's also a good part of planning. You are coming for an inner outer road and outer ring road and outer ring road 1 and outer ring road 2 and outer ring road 4. But then I feel that if we plan it properly now, it will save time, cost and all. So this is Bharatmala. A lot of information is there. Just one point. You can see the total length is what we are proposing by two. The Bharatmala is an ambitious project to be completed by 2022. The 75th year of, anybody? What is the 75th year in 2022? Why are the government programs benching on that 2022? Anybody can have a take? Yes. Great, huh? I must give you a chocolate also. Yeah, we'll meet. We'll definitely meet. 2022 ambitious program. यहाँ पे लिखा है कि 24,800 the right corner kilometers, but yes, we are also focusing, as I said at the start, 10,000 kilometers of the languishing projects of NHDP. जब रोड बनना शुरू हुए थे तो ऐसा नहीं था कि सब जगह रोड बन गए. ग्वालियर झांसी स्ट्रेच आज भी नहीं बना. भोपाल बैतूल स्ट्रेच आज भी नहीं बना. There are many reasons: forest, green cover, environmental clearances. In the hilly areas, there are issues, defense concern. We are coming up with that 10,000 kilometer languishing project in Bharatmala. Again, when I talk of the coastal roads here, almost that is 2,000 kilometer. It means we are in convergence with Sagarmala. Now, Sagarmala is a connectivity project of Ministry of Shipping, our sister ministry, where we are giving the connectivity to ports, the major and the non-major ports. And the non-major ports means, again, not only minor ports, but the private ports which are coming up, like Kandla and all, with there are ROBs and ring roads and bypasses. So that's a big convergence we are having with Sagarmala. And again, one more thing, interesting thing which may come up, that is the hilly areas road. And we are going for that Parvatmala. So these are some things which we'll read in newspaper soon. But the policy making part is going so fast and so quickly. So you can just guess it. Now I will come to my first two words of the title of my presentation, that is Sustainable National Highways. Sustainable National highways, we can say the green highways and all that, many of the matter is there, we can read and we know. But yes, climate resilience is one thing, green national highways, net zero energy, recycled material, efficient movement of freight passenger, use of electric vehicles and alternative fuels. The fifth box in between, when we say of movement of freight passenger, why? See, we are just 2% of the length of the total road network. Can you believe? We are just 2% of road network, but we carry 40% of passenger traffic and 60% of freight traffic. Now, this you can just see and just imagine the pressure on the roads, on the highways. They are the major lifelines of India. They are the major arteries of the nation. Now, about climate resilience, these are some open facts today. Not so good, but in a very extreme way, they are the facts, and we need to work on them. For us, apart from the nation, which is the fourth largest greenhouse gas emitter, transport sector contributes. Yes, it contributes, and you all very well know why. And where we sit here in Delhi, it's again, you know all that it's a polluted city. Why? Transport again, after industry is almost 54%, which have increased in the last 6 years among all the sectors. We have one of the largest and densest road network. And what we have committed at an international level for United Nations framework convention of climate change is that we will bring it to almost low level by 2030. So we have just 12 years in hand and we have committed, we have signed that. So aisa nahi hai ki jab road bana rahe hai and we are going ahead with all that concrete and civil engineering, but yes, we care for our children, we care for the nature. And I will give you one interesting example. There was a road to be built in Kashmir. I was told, main to abhi join kiya hai, and when a road is built in Kashmir, it was connecting obviously two points, and you know it's a temperate region with a coniferous forest. The pear and pines and coniferous cover. Jab road dono taraf matlab expand karna tha, it was such a beautiful track that you are going to a valley, for example in Pehalgam, and you can see ki yaar ye nahi yaar ye road banega, but ye itne sare khoobsurat ped hai, ye to gir jayenge, inko to kaatna hi hai. But in Bharatmala we came with a policy decision. When we are expanding the road on the two flanks of a brownfield project, existing road, why the two flanks? For the safety and to avoid and to safeguard the forest cover on one side, we will expand it to one length. So instead of two sides, it will come on one side. Dono part ke road trees kaatne ke bajaye acha hai ki we will just cut it on one side. So then it happened, and yesterday I was in a meeting with Ministry of Environment and Forest, and they appreciated this. They said that yes, it's not like there is always a feeling, a theme, a taste for environment and nature. That was one example. Yes, we need forest, we need tree covers as additional carbon sink. And we have come up with an infrastructure fragility index and also a disaster index. These are some of the current facts and challenges. We came up on a study with a consultant Terry on climate resilience. See, the study was basically to understand and to document the facts. For us too, it was very important because the operation and the maintenance part. One road, if we build two same roads in Rajasthan and in Meghalaya, the life will be different. Kyun Rahul ji, sahi hai? Agar main ek hi prakar ka road banata ho, they are my implementing and execution part, they are in a they have a better knowledge to speak on that. But agar aap bhi samajhte hai ki ek hi prakar ka agar hum road banate hai, if we make it in Rajasthan and Meghalaya, in a dry desert and a rainforest, rainy area, the life obviously is not the same. One may go for 3 years, one may go for 5 years without maintenance, with maintenance. So it was very important for us to understand. We have the climatic zones, I know, but even then, now with the current situation with the global warming and urbanization, a lot of things coming up, popping up, that was very important. So Terry came up and gave us a report. Then the methodology for the assessment for the vulnerable part, and again interventions. Interventions are of many types, but obviously engineering and non-engineering. Report to bahut badi hai, report bante rehte hai, report achhi hai, report padhne jaye to it will take 7 to 10 days I think, but again region wise, yes, it covered a lot. Climate stresses, what actually affect, what actually pinch there is very important. Why a landslide in Western Ghats? Why a cave in near Arunachal, near Tawang? Why sedimentation near coastal areas? Why? Many reasons. But this is all scientific. Geography and geology helps us, and we got a very good input, because as we say that climate change, global warming is our concern. We just not need to fight that. We need to see that what steps we are taking, we can take in the engineering models, in the interventions, at the policy level. I was reading ET, I think last week, I saw that when a train in Japan goes, And when the people are traveling, oh, hello, we have a friend from Japan. Wow, welcome, welcome, sir. And as soon as there is the seismic event, there is an earthquake, there is a seismic event, and the Richter scale goes above 4, the train stops. Now, this is technology. Technology to save lives of people, and technology to save, obviously, human and property, the national assets. So there is a lot of things to do. So for example, if I go for that disaster risk index or the seismic zones, we know that where are we sitting. Even Delhi, the last month, we had some tremors here. But they are very minute, less than 3 or less than 4 Richter scale. But in that way, we can plan better, again for the coastal and that part. I will not go in deep, but there are some photos also, which I've kept. This is something, there are the maps of, the three maps of our country. We show some few things. You can have a look. I will also do one thing, I will give a presentation copy to the organizers. So those who are interested, and for more details, they can just also log on to www.mor.gov.in. The second part, apart from climate resilience, obviously carbon footprint, reducing it. See, basically carbon footprint for us, we have seen it in three ways, three components basically. The first is construction, maintenance and operations. Now how to do, why to do, where to do, that all W's are here. You can see from the circle, from the, it's not a pie chart, but a circle representing construction, maintenance and operations. Operations, it's 86%, the share of emission which contributes to the carbon footprint. And really it's very serious. For India, as a developing nation, it's a time to take a call. We need to make roads, we need to have a very good infrastructure in cities, in ports, everywhere. We need infrastructure, we need roads, we can't avoid that. But now these things are very serious, I will say. And see the growth. You can see the growth, there are numbers, but just the ascent from 2016-17 and what will happen 2030. That's why we have signed the United Nations Framework Convention of Climate Change for the 2030 commitment. And transport sector plays a vital role. You know why we have diesel and petrol vehicles. From the last few days, it's also something buzzing around the prices. Thank you. There will be questions that electric cars, green cars and all coming up, kab aayenge. I think every automotive major have already kept a plan ready. The research is already over, that how they will come with the green cars or electric cars, and even at the policy level, the charging stations, ki gaadi ka charging kaha hoga, parking mein hoga, main ghar, raat ko ghar pe aunga, to gaadi ghar pe hogi, parking place pe hogi, mall pe hoga, on the way roadside hoga, whatever. I think that lot of things can be discussed here, but to be brief, to be short, yes, this is serious. Solutions. See, mitigation measures for us, specifically when we are building roads and highways, yes, we are doing and we will do it for the hilly areas and the coastal areas. For hilly areas, like obviously, slope stabilization to avoid the landslides, landslips, rocks falling. You can see when you go to the hilly areas or towards even the Ghar, there are nets. Nets crawl over the mountains just to avoid the damage. Drainage system is again, when I say climate change, you know, a very erratic pattern of rainfall is coming up. Delhi, even Delhi last month, I think month end, had thunderstorms and showers. which cool down the climate. So somewhere where it used to rain, it's raining much, raining higher. Jab barish nahi hoti thi, wahan aur kam barish ho rahi hai. Wheat area mein, in the area of wheat, we are getting a rainfall of rice. In the area of rice, we are getting a rainfall of wheat. Just to say that, it's erratic. And you know, very unforeseen. Coastal areas, obviously, some parts are going down gradually, some parts are coming up. For us, it's again, I think NHIDCL is also working in Andaman and Nicobar, Rahul sir, right? We are going there, and there's a lot of green forest. See, India is a biodiversity hotspot. You all know, we are a biodiversity hotspot in Northeast and Western Ghats. So, when these things come, like coastal planning and hilly areas, or in that way, the desert areas, lot of technological and engineering interventions are being done, and we are in process. The mitigation measures, obviously, for the construction phase, I will give an example. What? We have a map, we have a data of critically polluted areas in India. You can can you name any three critically polluted areas of India? Anyone, please? Just your hand, please. Kaun bola? Huh. Delhi, Calcutta? Two. They are the metros, obviously, but any, you know, tier two, that way, I think, kaisa hai? Kanpur kaisa hai? Is Kanpur? Gwalior. You are from Gwalior? No. Chalo. For example, what we have committed is, and when we have an agreement with the contractor, with the concessionaire, the contractor who builds the highways for us, that, for example, in a construction phase, you will not smoke out or install a plant which is emitting a lot of smoke 10 kilometers up and down of that critically polluted area. That's a commitment. It's very easy. You know, what happens is, why it happens and happens and happens in one place and not happen in other place, because it's in that place. So, we have the map of the critical polluted areas, and we have signed, whenever we sign whatever the agreement or the contract with the contractor, we come up that he will not do it in the critical polluted areas, so to avoid it. Again, the operation phase is a minor one of alternative fuel, electric vehicles, electronic toll collection and all. 27th of this month, we are inaugurating one of the biggest and ambitious project of NHAI, that is, anybody? Yeah, the Delhi Meerut Peripheral Expressway is a 128 kilometer something expressway with vertical gardens and intelligent transportation system and whatnot. I think you must travel. At least at night, you must go for a car drive and see how it's different from the other parts of India. Maintenance phase, again, yes. Now, this is something where we need to think a lot. As I showed, it contributes to 86% of the total emissions and contributing to the carbon hazard. I have spoken on Bharatmala, the National Road Transport Strategy. We are coming up. With World Bank, we are having a project with the World Bank. We are coming up with some 25 to 30 studies with the help of World Bank, which includes hilly areas and all. But again, this National Road Transport Strategy is that strategy which really matter. And it's the deadline is 2030, like identification of new technologies and clean fuels and multimodal integration, value engineering. Now see, this study is also coming up with World Bank. And a reputed consultant of United States is working on this. Here we are seeing that how we can stop that, how we can help in avoiding the carbon footprints and in a way to climate change. Lot of SOPs, standard operating procedures and protocols are coming up. For the first being the technology-based road maintenance protocol. I was just talking about the Eastern Peripheral Expressway, which have solar lighting, vertical gardens, and solar lighting of 4 megawatt. You will not believe. That's why I said you must go have a car drive there. After 27th of May. ITS, intelligent transport system, and we are coming up with many innovations like fast tags. For example, why you will say I am putting this ETC here? We are way behind in ETC, yes. You go on a toll, sometimes you see there are 50 cars ahead of you. And 25 to 35 minutes you are here and there, you are seeing, and then you reach, you give him some a note, and then he gives you a slip, and then he takes. But now see the timing. And by that time, your vehicle is pumping that poisonous gas into air, right? But it, with ETC, swiftly you can come and go. So the standing time, the parking time of 25 to 35 minutes sometimes, if avoided, will it not decrease the greenhouse gases, the carbon emissions? Yes? So technological interventions are not only for us, for humans, but I feel that it also will bring down. So that's all. Thank you. I thought that I was the first session and I was told to come up with this. Any questions, any answers, please let me know. Yes. Just give me mic, please. Just please your name and your, in the mic.
Hello everyone, my name is Atmik and I am working in AECOM as a highway engineer.
Akash.
Atmik.
Atmik.
Yes. So I have seen that lot of time is wasted in land acquisition process. Basically, you know, we have to identify, first of all, we have to identify the areas in which we are acquiring land. And then we have to visit that particular office or patwari to identify that. So when we visit them, they do not know where, whose land is this and whose, when we provide them our maps, then also they are unable to, you know, answer our queries. So basically, the problem, the lot of time is wasted there. And my question is, why do government does not come with alternative proposal to provide a particular website that, like you have land acquisition portal? So we have to identify that particular areas and then we have to enter all the details in it. So why government does not enter all those details already? They do not provide those, so we can directly identify from that portal. So basically, that's the point.
Yes. See, a very good question, where we are very much seriously concerned. As I stated at the start of my presentation, land is a precious resource, and we need land for development. Now, see the land, Atmik, na?
Yes.
Atmik land, you know, across the country, in a union of India, states. It's a subject with the state delayed. I felt that you are saying that why not we can digitize and have a digital platform, a digital layer of land maps.
Yes.
Uniform across India, right?
Yes.
See, the, all the states are having some part of land numbering and land maps into that digital part, but the levels are different. Some states have done a wonderful job, some states are not, one thing. So it's not uniform. Second, yes, issues are there, problems are there, litigation issues arise that hampers the project. We, on our part, we have come up with a portal, Bhumi Rashi portal. Now the Bhumi Rashi portal is a land acquisition portal where the district collector, which we say that there are 650 districts in India and we count them as units, the basic nuts and bolts of land acquisition. Because they have to spearhead. We are there, but we will just help them. So there is a portal, Bhumi Rashi portal, where 3A, 3B, 3C, 3D, whatever, we keep on doing it. We keep on uploading, we keep on processing. The funds are even transferred through that portal. So the first part was here, standing this side of the part, you know, I'm sitting this side of the table. I can say that there were some issues. So we have sorted out on our part. So making it IT friendly, transparent, swift, yes. Now the issues have almost minimized and it may be almost 90% have come down. But again, now what we are coming up with an, you know, land asset bank. We have requested to the states also, those who are coming up. I just mentioned the grand challenge. Now what is grand challenge? The grand challenge mechanism is a mechanism that whoever offered the challenge that I have 80% of the land, go with the project. If Gujarat, Andhra, Meghalaya, Sikkim, anybody says, yes, we have land, I will say go with the project. We are funding it. Funding is not an issue, land is an issue. So we came with this policy decision. And again, to speak on that, you know, there are many such fall, like litigation is there, and you know, acquisition and demarcation. Some states have come up with a very good models apart from Land Acquisition Act, like directly compensating the owner, the farmer. तू जो बोलता है क्या बोल रहे हैं 150 ले लो 150 लैंड दे दो ऑल ही विल गो टू द सिविल कोर्ट द हाई कोर्ट फॉर रेफरेंस एंड ऑल एंड इट स्टैगर्स फॉर 4, 5, 15 इयर्स सो यस वी आर कमिंग अप वी ऑलरेडी हैव सम टूल्स आईटी टूल्स नाउ एज कंपेयर टू द लास्ट डिकेड यू कैन सी द अवार्ड्स एंड द कंस्ट्रक्शन रेट वाई द कंस्ट्रक्शन रेट हैव इम्प्रूव्ड फ्रॉम 10 किलोमीटर्स पर ईयर per day to 27 plus because of land. So that's a simple indicator that we have moved very positively on land. And yes, in the coming decade, in the coming year, I will say, next 2 years, almost many of the issues will be solved. Thank you.
Thank you.
I am Sai Kumar from Hikvision. First of all, sir, it was a very good presentation.
And thank you.
I want to, since you are talking on road safety and all, so we are from a surveillance company, cameras okay. and all. And if you know that currently lot of ITS project and a lot of intelligent things can be done through cameras itself, by which a lot of safety aspect and other human resources can be avoided and lot of benefits will be given to the department. So I want to understand from you, since we don't get much forums where we can ask related to surveillance, what is your take on surveillance system for highways and all? Like how you are planning, whether it will be compulsory and how it will be helping the, I mean, how government is looking after that. And also since you are from North, sir, what is your take on public safety in buses, etc.? Because there have been talks going on, but the STUs, I've been waiting for more that how it will be done. So if you can just throw a light on what is your vision related to that.
Sai, right?
Yeah, Sai Kumar.
Sai, see, there's a very good news for you and you must be knowing that yes, we are very much green, not only for this green, I'm saying yes for that surveillance part as you are focusing. But now see, that's a comprehensive way. Surveillance is just one part in IT. When we talk about the comprehensive package, to be intelligent, to be transparent, to be more, you know, as a public safety you were saying, many things have come up. CCTV cameras and, you know, all is coming on net and mobile apps and all cell phones. Yes, we are doing it. That's why I just said to see our model expressway, you must travel across that peripheral eastern way and you will see it have an ITS. Now ITS, you must be knowing, it's an, includes all. So we are very much concerned on surveillance and we are doing that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Good morning, sir.
Himanshu.
Prashant.
Prashant, sorry.
I am an urban planner and I must really appreciate the application of ITS and your quoting the Japanese technology regarding the P and S waves. Sir, I have a really small question. It doesn't matter whether you increase the lane number of lanes from 8 to 16, but there still will be congestion. Highway ka lanes badhayenge to log gaadiyan zyada layenge. So, is there any plan for switching to the public rapid transit system on the highway expansion project as well? What yes. are the other options which will be available?
Apart from MRTS?
Yes, sir. I mean, including even any new innovations in MRTS as well.
Including MRTS and excluding MRTS?
Anywhere. Any kind of rapid transit system, be it public rapid transit system, mass rapid transit system.
Yes.
Anything. Any okay. new innovations, basically.
Just, I will just... I will try to speak on that. See, you have asked an innovative question and I will give an innovative answer.
Much appreciated.
Obviously, there is a BRTS. We have now a very traditional conventional approach in Indore, in Pune and everywhere, which is somehow more or less is going on. That is a bus rapid transit system. Now, see, these are all a part of MRTS. When we, you are talking of rapid, the rapidness, all the swiftness, all the dedicatedness comes in MRTS. So mass rapid transport system is actually the umbrella word, and then there are flanks, like one is the BRTS, one is the many things which are just moving the public passenger from one place to another in short time. Sorry. So yes, now when we have land for building highways and roads, we already have land, we are getting land. So, passing on and facilitating public transport, the major concern to push people or just to facilitate travel of people from point A to point B is our major concern. Okay, agar hum wo nahi karenge, to sab log apni apni gaadi lete hai, two-wheeler lete hai, four-wheeler lete hai. Aap dekho ek ghar ke saamne char-char two-wheeler, four-wheeler khadi hai, kyunki sabko apne apne jagah jana hai. Then that contributes to emission and pollution. Because my presentation focuses on that. So why? What we are doing is, for example, the metro part. The metros are coming up all over India. Delhi have a DMRC. Bangalore, Ahmedabad, Mumbai, many cities are coming. Pune is coming, Nagpur is coming up very shortly. So what we are planning is, we are trying to have understanding with them. Because somewhere we overlap, we interconnect. Either our highway will go above the metro in the city or the peripheral of the city, or it will go inside. Or the metro will come after us. But mostly what happens on the roads, now metro as being a new corporation, it is coming up. So one is that. Second, in the city transport, we have the BRTS, and where the state are eager, we do give a proper ratio or a portion of land to the local authorities, the state government, or whatever company it is formed, SPV, special purpose vehicle or what, because we feel that they are helping us and we are helping them. So yes, we are coming up. Not even that, I will say we have a road in the hilly areas of Kashmir, Jammu Kashmir, Himachal, Uttaranchal, Assam and all, Sikkim. A road takes almost 120 kilometers in the hilly areas from point A to B, right? And all that meandering and the serpentine motion, we are go there, it will take time. Lot of pollution in that green biodiversity hotspot. We are having a study to have ropeways. So we have an option, and not only ropeways for tourists. In India, what's happening is, we have a conventional concept of ropeways are for tourists. Aisa nahi hai. Now, we should go, apart from tourists, obviously tourists to hai, tourists to aayenge, but even for the local economy, the local citizens, the passengers, the freight, the carriageway, there are some examples in Europe and you know, you can search on the net, where this part, so you were just speaking on the mainland India, apart from that, I am also speaking and giving an example of that hilly area, so there is a study coming up. And there are two projects each coming in Himachal and Uttaranchal. That is the way ahead. Thank you. Yes, one more. No. Hayes, kya?
अपने यहाँ की बात करते हैं आगरा हाईवे निकला हुआ हमारे यहाँ से लैंड कॉस्ट इंक्रीज कर गई वहाँ के लोकल ब्लेजर्स की इनकम इंक्रीज नहीं कर पाई, उनको वहाँ सर्वाइव करना भी मुश्किल पड़ रहा है, जो इंडस्ट्री है वो उसको टेक ओवर कर रही है। हम उस फार्मर के लिए क्या कर सकते हैं जिसकी हम लेन ले रहे हैं, उसकी इकोनॉमिकल हम एक बार कॉस्ट पे करके उसके नियरेस्ट जो फार्मर हैं उनकी तो कॉस्ट नहीं मिल रही है उस हाईवे से जाने से, उसके लिए आपका क्या प्रपोजल है? सपोज यूपी गवर्नमेंट की एक स्कीम है वन डिस्ट्रिक्ट वन प्रोजेक्ट, हर एक डिस्ट्रिक्ट का अपना एक प्रोजेक्ट होता है, क्यों ना हाईवे उतारती उस डिस्ट्रिक्ट के प्रोजेक्ट को उस हाईवे पर कहीं ना कहीं डोनेट करे दिखाए, तो वहाँ के जो निकलेगा मतलब पर्सन उनको उस चीज़ का नॉलेज मिलेगी और उससे उस डिस्ट्रिक्ट का भी उस ब्लेजर का भी इकोनॉमिकल सेक्टर में डेवलपमेंट होगा। इस पर हाईवे अथॉरिटी
शुभ नाम क्या है?
अभिनय गुप्ता।
अमय।
अभिनय गुप्ता।
अभिनय सॉरी अभिनय जी, बहुत ही अच्छा सवाल किया आपने, अब बैठ सकते हैं, थैंक यू। देखिए हमारा कोर कंसर्न हाईवे डेवलपमेंट है ऑब्वियसली, है ना, हमारा जो मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव है। पर हाँ, ये जो बातें आपने रखी है कि लोकल डेवलपमेंट और यू नो जो स्थानीय स्तर पर रोजगार हो और समृद्धि हो और वो सब जो आप कह रहे हैं, फार्मर लेवल पे भी आपने बात की, अच्छा लगा। ये हमारा वैसे प्राइमरी ऑब्जेक्टिव नहीं है और आप सहमत भी होंगे कि हमारा काम रोड बनाना है और वहाँ के जो राज्य है, ज़िले है और जो नीचे देख रहे हैं, है ना, यही सवाल मैं आपके गाँव के प्रधान को भी कर सकता हूँ कि भाई तुम क्यों नहीं कर रहे हो, मैं तो तुम्हारे यहाँ रोड बना रहा हूँ। तो ठीक है, मैं इसको ऐसे कहूँगा कि देखिए रोड्स का ऑब्वियसली एक लिमिटेशन भी होता है, एक अलाइनमेंट है, एक सिस्टम है जहाँ से हमें जाना है और उतना करना है, परंतु हमने फिर हमारे स्तर पे ऐसा किया है कि एक पॉलिसी आई है हाईवे नेस्ट विलेज। हाईवे नेस्ट चिड़िया का घोंसला होता है ना, घोंसला, नेस्ट बोलते हैं उसको इंग्लिश में, तो नेस्ट राजमार्ग घोंसला, अब उसका ऐसा कोई हिंदी ट्रांसलेशन नहीं है परंतु मैं बता रहा हूँ, हाईवे नेस्ट विलेजेस, वो कि जहाँ आप जा, एग्जांपल मैं दे रहा हूँ, बहुत ही ख़राब एक स्थिति होती है जब हम ट्रैवल करते हैं और वी जस्ट वांट टू वेट फॉर सम रिफ्रेशमेंट और वॉट एवर टू गो फॉर अ लू, हम में से 99% लोग बोलेंगे कि यार मतलब कहीं फैसिलिटीज़ नहीं, एमिनिटीज़ नहीं है, वी कैन वेट, वी कैन फ्रेश अप और वॉट एवर, है ना। तो हम इसके साथ आ रहे हैं। फिर दूसरी बात देखिए, जब भी जब कोई रोड और हाईवे बनता है तो उसके आसपास डेवलपमेंट होती है, ऐसा नहीं होगा कि उसके रेट्स नहीं बढ़े या उसके पास विकास नहीं हुआ। भारतमाला में जब बात कर रहा था, आप आए थे जब मैं भारतमाला पर बात कर रहा था, आप लेट आए थोड़े, मैं पुनः एक बार दोहराता हूँ, भारतमाला परियोजना एक ऐसी परियोजना है जहाँ पर हम जो हमारे नए अलाइनमेंट है, जैसे कि मुझे दिल्ली से लखनऊ जाना है, आप कैसे जाओ, आप कौन से राज्य से हो, यूपी से हो, अरे वाह, वही मैं बोल रहा हूँ, दिल्ली से लखनऊ जा रहा हो तो आप कैसे कैसे जाते हो अभी, उससे जा रहे हो, ठीक है, क्योंकि वहाँ बन चुका है तो उसकी बात नहीं करेंगे, लेकिन मैं कहूँ आपको कि अब हम ऐसा एक रोड बना रहे हैं, ऐसा कोई रोड नहीं बन रहा है, लेकिन अगर ऐसा कहीं दूसरी जगह बनना होता तो सीधे जाना है। हम क्यों बना रहे हैं, ऑब्वियसली जो इन्होंने सवाल पूछा कि ज़मीन महंगी है, ज़मीन मिलती नहीं है, तो ज़मीन का एक इशू है कि हम बड़े बड़े शहरों से जाए, ज़मीन महंगी है लेकिन हम बाहर से जा रहे हैं। ओके ओके ओके, वी स्टॉप द क्वेश्चन, दिस इज द लास्ट क्वेश्चन, आई हैव बीन टोल्ड बाय द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स टू स्टॉप, बट दिस इज द लास्ट आंसर आई एम गिविंग एंड आई विल बी हैप्पी टू इंटरेक्ट विथ यू ऑन द फ्लोर, आई विल बी कमिंग एंड विल इंटरेक्ट। तो ये है, तो अभी जो नया अलाइनमेंट होगा वो नए गाँव नए खेतों से जाएगा, वह पहली बार रोड बनेगा तो विकास होगा, मतलब फायदा होगा, समृद्धि होगी। थैंक यू, थैंक्स अ लॉट। सो आई विल ऑल्सो इन्वाइट मिस्टर सुधीर माथुर नाउ, सीनियर साइंटिस्ट CSIR, टू प्लीज कम एंड हैव हिज वर्ड्स।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू, इनफैक्ट वी हैड एन एक्सीलेंट presentation by the chairman of the session, and he has given you an overview of golden quadrilateral north south east roads, then Bharat Mala, Parbat Mala, climate change, and what are the steps the Ministry of Road Transport is taking to make the roads sustainable. In fact, you know, in road construction, It is very, very difficult to really quantify what is truly sustainable. As a matter of fact, in road sector produces the highest level of greenhouse gases. In fact, today we are talking about the sustainable roads, you know. So the road produces the highest level of greenhouse gases directly to energy use. We mine the materials, then we transport them, we lay them, we make roads, and once the road is ready, then the vehicles move over it, and that produces a lot of pollution. And then, because of this constant increase in traffic, it generates substantial amount of air pollutants. Now, to be sustainable, the challenge is to make cheaper and better production, reduce the cost of construction and maintenance. But on the other hand, as we know, that the raw materials are becoming scarce. There's a lot of environmental laws which are getting stricter day by day, and they are saying that use the locally available materials, use waste materials, other marginal materials. So these are the challenges and how to make the best use of these materials. So in fact, for sustainability in highways, we should have low energy consumption, low emission and air pollutants, reduced use of virgin materials in construction, and increased use of recycled materials. Of course, as the chairman has also pointed out, that we have to have safer highways, we have to promote sustainable transport, and now a new concept has also coming up, the perpetual payment, the payment which is very, very, very long lasting. So, you know, if we come to the sustainable highways, I will just talk, because the time given is only 5 minutes to me by the organizers, so I will be very, very brief. See, we have to go for new technologies, and only by adopting the new technologies, we can really make sustainable highways, long-lasting highways. So now let us talk about first. The top layer is the bituminous layer. There we have new technologies like emulsion-based cold mix construction, then warm mix technology and half warm mix technology. What is warm mix and half warm mix? In fact, actually, when we lay the bituminous pavement, we heat the bitumen up to a temperature of 160 degree or 170 degree. Then bring that mix to the road, and then lay it at a temperature of 110, 120 degrees centigrade. In the half warm mix technology, instead of heating the bitumen to a temperature of 160 to 170, we can heat the bitumen up to a temperature of 120 and 130 and compact it at the temperature of 80 degree. But for that, we have to add some additives into it, and which has a cost. But of course, such a technology, it may be at par with the conventional technology, but of course, it reduces the pollutants. Then use of waste plastic. If you travel any part of the country, lot of plastics are, you know, being dumped here and there. So that plastic can be used in bituminous construction, and we have done lot of work. Even Indian Road Congress has brought out the guidelines also. And, you know, we have seen that if we use the waste plastic in bituminous construction, the road's life has enhanced because it improves the fatigue life. You know, by adding plastic into the bituminous waste, it improves the elastic properties of the bituminous mixes.
So this is an excellent material which can be used, which is abundantly available in our country. Then recycling, use of recycled asphalt pavement, use of recycled concrete aggregate. You know, whenever there is a deterioration in the road, we put another layer of bituminous pavement, then another layer of bitumen, and the levels of the roads are going high and high. And as a result, there is a serious problem of drainage. In many places, you might be seeing that the water from the road is going into the houses of the people. So, you know, and on the other hand, we don't have aggregates to make thick bituminous layer. So why not we recycle whatever is already there, remove it, recycle it, and then reuse it. So those technologies are available, but unfortunately, they are not being adopted in our country. Then there are a lot of waste materials, like fly ash, iron and steel slag, copper slag, construction and demolition waste, and lot of waste material, lot of, hundreds of waste materials are available, which can be used for road construction in our country. The technologies are already available. Only thing is that people do not have confidence in those kind of materials. So I think we have to have more number of such roads in our country. We should construct large number of roads with such type of materials. We should do performance evaluation of those roads, and that should be brought to the contractors and the consultants so that people start using such type of materials. Then locally available materials. Sometimes the locally available materials don't meet the standards and specifications as laid by Indian Road Congress or Ministry of Road Transport guidelines. But if we just mix them with some other materials or stabilize them with cement, lime, fly ash, etc., so they can be reused. Then perpetual pavement concept has already come. And then there are many alternative synthetic materials like geosynthetics, which can be used in the highway to enhance the performance of the road structure. But, you know, we all know about all these things, but there are certain bottlenecks. Why we are not using these type of alternative materials, alternative technologies? The biggest problem I feel that first of all, it should be brought in the DPR stage itself. We should not expect that the contractor will bring something, you know. At the DPR stage itself, the DPR consultant should be instructed that before going for conventional materials or conventional technologies, he must explore the use of alternative waste and marginal materials. When he says that it is not possible, then only he should be allowed to go for other technologies. And nowadays, you know, when we ask the DPR consultant, okay, you make a DPR, we give hardly few months time or hardly a year. At that time, he has no time to look at the what kind of other alternative materials. So I think the government should take initiative, and for that, we should map the available road construction materials, including all possible waste. And I think this step should be taken by at the government level. It can be taken at the state level, it can be taken at the nation level, maybe with the help of CRRI, IRC, and other organization. But whatever the materials are available all over the country, that should be mapped, their properties should be known, so that the contractor and the consultant who are preparing the DPR, they must have the first-hand information about that. Then there should be a policy framework for mutual cooperation and understanding between the industry and the contracting agency. And guidelines should be brought out about the merits and demerits of the new technologies. For example, cold mix technology is now people talk about, where we don't heat the bitumen. We mix the aggregate with the emulsion. But the problem is that the cold mix, you know, which is the mix which is coming out, is not as strong as the mix which is coming out with the hot bitumen. So the cold mix technology is very good as far as the low volume roads are concerned. But it is not really good where the traffic is high or heavy density traffic corridors are there. Similarly, as I have talked about the waste plastics. Now, waste plastic technology is well established, but the plastic, I think that some effort should be made by the government to make the waste plastic the suitable type of waste plastic, or not all plastic can be mixed in the bituminous layer. Suitable type of waste plastic should be made available at one particular place. Maybe in a city, you know, 3-4 locations could be there, or in a region-wise, some locations could. So that the contractor goes and get the waste plastic from there itself and mix it in the bituminous mixes. So these are some of the things which we should really think. And then those contractors who are really adopting the new technologies, there should be some incentive. They should be incentivized. Otherwise, they will not really come forward, because every contractor has a fear in his mind that, you know, if I go for this new technology and suppose tomorrow it fails. Then another important thing is that the government should also take the responsibility. You know, we say that, okay, these are the new technologies, you use it. But tomorrow if it fails, then the contractor will be responsible. No, that's not the correct policy. I think the government should also take some responsibility that, okay, if you are going for new construction methods, new technologies, or new design methods, which is cheaper, which leads to sustainable highways, I think some responsibility should be taken by the government agency. So these are some of the points which I just wanted to discuss. Thank you very much.
I have been told to moderate also. So as a moderator, any questions for sir? Because I've been told also to, we have less time, hardly 15 minutes. So what we can do is we can have questions at the end. I request Mr. Rakesh Kumar Agrawal, sir, please. Okay, not much to say. So with a short of time, Rahul Gupta, sir. Please, thank you.
Good morning. Distinguished guests on the dais, organizers, ladies and gentlemen. I will limit my deliberations to the development of road infrastructure in Northeast region and strategic areas abutting the international border of the country. As Mr. Sanket has already told, that Government of India has created a new organization, that is National Highway Infrastructure and Development Corporation, to take up the highway development work in these remote areas. These areas are primarily undeveloped on account of their locations in the hilly and mountainous terrain and inclement climatic conditions. Physical connectivity in these areas, along with the seamless connectivity with the neighboring countries, like Asian countries or BBIN countries, that is Bharat, that is Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, and Nepal, is must to realize their full economic potential. This objective can be achieved by development of a robust infrastructure of roads and highways. So in order to achieve this objective and to fast-pace the construction of national highways and other infrastructure in these regions, a new organization, that is National Highway Infrastructure Development Corporation, was created. Initially, this organization was entrusted with the responsibility of development of 10,000 kilometers of highways in Northeast region. Which includes the international trade corridors, And on completion of these roads, it would enable the safe and efficient transportation with the SASEC member countries, in addition to promoting the cross-border trade and securing international borders. As on date, NHIDCL is working in 13 states, that 8 states in Northeast region, including Sikkim, and 5 other states from Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, West Bengal, and Andaman and Nicobar. This is a glimpse of the works are being taken up by NHIDCL. The total civil works in progress is of the order of 2,750 kilometers at a cost of around 45,000 crores. And the DPRs in a length of around 10,500 kilometers are in progress. With the works will be around, will call the, after completion, when the civil works will be of the order of around 1,67,000 crores. Now I will give you a glimpse of the highway construction or development work in various states being taken up by NHIDCL. In Assam, 380 kilometers of four laning is in progress. It is under implementation, and primarily one section NH-37, which is lifeline to the Assam for the eastern part, that is from Numaligarh to Dibrugarh, it is in progress. And second access is NH-52 from Naugaon to Holangi, which will providing connectivity to Itanagar in Arunachal Pradesh. Four new bridges across Brahmaputra have been planned. First is Kalia Bhomra Bridge near Tejpur. It is 3.2 kilometers in length. The cost of this bridge is around 600 crores and is to be completed by 2020. Second bridge is Dhubli Furbari Bridge. The length of this bridge will be 20 kilometers long and it will be the longest river crossing in the country. And this work has been planned to be awarded for construction during this year. Third bridge is between Numaligarh and Gopur. This bridge will be 9 kilometers long, and its detailed project report is being prepared. And the fourth bridge is Jogi Gopha Bridge. This is a new two-lane bridge adjacent to the existing two-lane bridge at Jogi Gopha. And its DPR is also being prepared. And this is a part of Bharatmala project. This is a Kalia Bhomra Bridge, which is under construction. You can see on left-hand side, there is an existing bridge, and these structures on the right-hand side are of the new bridge. The piers has already been erected. And now the superstructure is being launched. Another major project. Another major project is a Jojila tunnel. It is being planned to provide all weather connectivity between Srinagar, Kargil, and Leh. This project has been recently, the foundation stone of this project has been recently laid by Honorable Prime Minister on 19th of May. This is the location of Jojila tunnel. And you can see this is the situation in winters, and this is a existing Jojila pass, and this pass remains closed for around 6 to 7 months in the year, and there is no communication possible except for the air transport between Leh and other mainland of the country. Another major project on the between Srinagar and Leh is Jedmor tunnel. This is basically a tunnel being constructed to bypass the Sonmarg area, which is avalanche prone. These works are in progress, and tunnel, this especially the escape tunnel, which is on the right-hand side, is likely to be completed by the end of next year. And the works is scheduled to complete it by 2022. Recently, Government of India has launched a Bharatmala Pariyojana, which is a very ambitious project for development of roads in the country, which the phase one of this Pariyojana includes 24,800 kilometers of development of 24,800 kilometers highways in the country. And out of this 24,800 kilometers, 5,800 kilometers, that is 22%, has been earmarked in the NER region. And for these 5,800 kilometers, NHAI will be the implementation agency. Out of these 5,800 kilometers, about 2,500 kilometer length pertain to border roads and international connectivity roads. The main feature of this Bharatmala Pariyojana is multimodal freight movement. And in Northeast, it will cover 7 waterway terminals on River Brahmaputra, which are to be linked with the roads. This is the details of Bharatmala Pariyojana in Northeast region. These are the various, as Mr. Sanket has already told, these are the 6 components of Bharatmala Pariyojana, and the share of Northeast and NHIDCL has been indicated therein. So NHIDCL will be developing around 6,000 kilometers at a cost of 1,20,000 crores. Another major feature or another major project being taken up by NHIDCL is development of a multimodal logistic park near Jogi Gopha in Assam. This MLPB is being developed on a land around 200 acres, which has been earmarked by Government of Assam. And after development of this multimodal logistic park, it is expected that connectivity of the region will improve with investment in road, rail, and waterways. NHIDCL is also actively involved in the implementation of Act East policy of Government of India. Presently, the prime reason for poor development of highway infrastructure or any transport infrastructure in Northeast region is the connectivity through the chicken neck only. So to develop the Northeast, we have to, in any case, provide connectivity with our neighboring countries. The main objective of Act East policy is to increase the trade with the Asian and BBIN countries, including creating industrial corridors and state-of-art border trade centers, seamless connectivity with Asian and BBIN countries, socio-cultural exchanges, and easier movement of people. So to achieve these objectives, the corridors planned for development to have an international connectivity are Agartala-Kolkata via Dhaka, Silchar-Kolkata, that is also via Dhaka, Guwahati-Shillong, Dhaka and Kolkata, Agartala-Sabroom-Chittagong. This Agartala to Sabroom section of this corridor has been substantially completed. 122 kilometer road length from Agartala to Sabroom is already operational. And a bridge across on Indo-Bangladesh border across River Feni is under construction. And efforts are being made through MEA to develop the connectivity from Sabroom to Chitgaon on the Bangladesh side. Other projects are Golaghat More, that is Indo-Myanmar border in Manipur. This will lead to merging with the trilateral highway. And across the border on trilateral highway, the works are in progress from Yagiku to Kalewa and being implemented by National Highway Authority of India. And the funding is being done by Ministry of External Affairs. Another project is Still Bell Road, that is NH-153, providing connectivity on the northern side of Myanmar, Silchar, Jiribam, More Road, and Imphal Mau Road. In addition, for development of highway infrastructure in the country, NHIDCL has taken some digital initiatives. One is Inampro, that is a marketplace for selling and buying cement, steel, and construction equipment and other highway construction material, facilitating the road infrastructure industry. And this portal has come up like Flipkart or Amazon for the construction industry. Second initiative is Infracon, that is a national portal for procurement of consultancy services adopted by Ministry of Road Transport and Highways and its executing agencies. And it has resulted in total elimination of the paperwork and imparted total objectivity and transparency to the bidding process. We are also actively engaged in the skill development of the highway construction workers and playing an active role under Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana. We have organized training camps in Northeast, and this year we plan to take up these training programs in Jammu Kashmir and other states of Northeast. These are the some glimpses of some works being carried, taken up in various parts, like in this in J&K, these are tunneling works. Works is in the Manipur, where the, you can see the condition of existing roads, and after improvement, they will be upgraded. These are works in progress in Tripura. These are works in progress in Assam. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rahulji. Actually, we are very late and a new session is beginning here. So we are just closing up here. For any other questions, we are coming on the floor and we can have a discussion. Thank you.
We now come to the end of the session. I thank my speakers for their valuable time and their remarks. I now request our chairperson for the session to hand over the token of appreciation to our speakers. I would now request Mr. Pramit Kumar, General Manager, Exhibitions India Group, to hand over the memento to our chairperson for the session. Thank you.